My name is Olle Johansson. I work at the Department of Neuroscience at the Karolinska Institute, and I'm heading a group called the Experimental Dermatology Unit. And for the last 30-35 years, we have been very much interested in health effects of man-made artificial electromagnetic fields. The last 30-40 years, there has been an enormous explosion in the use of electricity, electronics, computers, and now lately the wireless society has been built up. More and more of our things are communicating wirelessly through the use of microwaves, like mobile phones, tablets, and other such gadgets that we use at workplaces, schools, and in homes. When you read in the scientific literature in well-established and well-controlled research journals, you are struck by the enormous amount of papers clearly showing that these kind of electromagnetic fields we are talking about do have very scary in many instances and very strong effects at the molecular and cellular level, as well as the tissue and organ level, the animal level, the plant, bacteria, and human level. It's actually, for a scientist, it's a big enigma, a big question why society doesn't pay attention to this. And for, 2 years ago approximately, we formed a think tank. It's a very presumptuous word, but some kind of think tank, collecting a lot of very good people with background in journalism, politics, etc., and trying to come up with tools, new tools, to share the information with the general public as well as with people in power. And also we have investigated the possibility to use old tools, like YouTube, for instance, to impact on people. But unfortunately, people are more interested in the classical sex and violence stuff on television and radio and newspapers, and few pay attention. It's very hard to rank the different effects, but if I would try to rank them, I would, and that may be a surprise to many, I would put at the last place the cancer issue. The World Health Organization has cancer classified radiofrequent electromagnetic fields. Yes, but from a public health point of view, it's a very, very small question. The big issues are, of course, impacts on, for instance, bacteria, impacts on our immune system, our possibility to produce coming generations that we call fertility, and that kind of issues. And many of them are nowadays on a solid ground, and there has been groups formed, for instance, in the United States, trying to get politicians to understand that they need to reduce the exposure, particularly of women, of pregnant women, of babies, of children and teenagers. It's a very broad range. We have tried to add to the research field as good as we can, but in Sweden there has been a tremendous problem to get funding, but other countries have been much more lucky in that way. And today the number of published papers in peer-review-based scientific journals are many, many, many thousands of papers. So there is an enormous wealth of information, and based upon that, it's just to start to think about what should it be tomorrow. And I've coined the expression that we need to introduce tomorrow's green, human-friendly technology. And for instance, if you take a computer that is wireless or a mobile phone, and compare it with a wired computer or a wired telephone, the information is exactly the same. If I use a mobile phone, the things I say doesn't get more intelligent. It's just the same. So maybe the simple solution would be to take a few steps backwards and reintroducing wired systems, and especially in Sweden, we would be very happy because we have one of the biggest cable producers in the world in Sweden, so they would be very happy to re-cable the whole of society. The safety standards, or rather they are recommendations, they only take into account acute effects as short as down to 6 minutes of exposure, and no one uses their mobile phone, for instance, for 6 minutes and then never again. And it's also only taking into account so-called thermal or heating effects. And the issues are not there at all, and that we knew very early, already in the 1990s. And the issue instead is at non-thermal levels and long-term exposure, much more than just a few minutes. We're talking about months or years, and what happens then? The safety standards, or the recommendations that is set nowadays, they are based and controlled by fluid-filled plastic dolls, so-called phantom heads. And even the organization doing this have pointed out 2005 in London that their recommendations never were meant to be used in biology or medicine. It's a complete misconception of the rest of the society, and they want to wash their hands, saying that they never meant that. And unfortunately, the day after having said this in London, the same person from the same organization at another meeting in London seemingly had forgotten what he said the day before. So they don't really know how to put a stance on this, I would say. And at the same time, for instance, the European Commission has asked for new updated guidelines taking into account real biological measures, which so far hasn't been done. To be a scientist and trying to investigate this safe technologies, because society says through their authorities this is completely safe, just go ahead and use it, but it's very unsafe trying to question this and investigating it. And for myself, my personal experience, unfortunately I must admit that the cost has been too great. The number of drawbacks and slander and bullying and harassments and so on has been just too much and just too hard on me and my family. And the cost then has been just too great. And it's odd because I look upon myself as a mental fire brigade soldier. And just imagine if the ordinary fire brigade would be coming with the red trucks. We wouldn't be spitting at them. We wouldn't be shouting at them. No, we are very happy that they come. Even if it's a false alarm, we are very, very happy because our property, our life, and their lives are not at danger. We wouldn't be scolding them and saying, go to hell. But that's happened with the mental fire brigade soldiers, and it's a real disgrace to society and also a real danger. Somewhere along the road, they will throw out the important whistleblower, and that could mean the end, even for life and society. When you attend your grammar school and your high school and so on, you learn and you are taught that the civil society, including the big mother and father, the government and the parliament, they are all for you. They are to serve you, including the authorities and also the universities, of course. And if you read what famous thinkers wrote about the role of universities, they only talk about that they should be a public servant and they should only be based on need. What society needs, they should investigate. But the truth is that we are far, far, far from that. And nowadays, universities are based on personal career and also on profit. The developments should be turned into inventions to be sold, manufactured, and people should be gaining money from it. Different spin-off producers should see the light. And this is, of course, very far away from the basic idea. And I strongly sense we have to turn this boat around. We must. The mobile phone industry, they don't really have a role and shouldn't really have a role. Again, in a democratic society of the type we are talking about, the producers, the manufacturers, the operators and so on, they should not scrutinize their own product. We wouldn't believe that for food items or anything else, I mean. And it would be much better to have genuinely independent universities. And as soon as you have smoke somewhere coming in society, they should go there as the mental fire brigade soldiers, immediately with their toolboxes, investigating what is wrong. And of course, hopefully, it will turn out in the future that there wasn't any risk, everything was safe, but that would mean that thousands and thousands of published papers all must be wrong at the same time. And that has never, ever happened before. So the probability is zero, I would say. The very interesting research we have, and we haven't done that, there are American and English and other groups who have investigated, is of course effects on, for instance, memory and learning capability. Already the real great scientist Henry Lai and his colleagues could demonstrate that rats that were exposed to the Bluetooth frequency of 2.45 gigahertz that we use for wireless devices a lot in our society actually decreased the short-term memory capacity and the concentration capacity in rats that were to follow mazes to find food. And when that was repeated, but using young boys instead, and in a learning task at the school, and in a very elegant double-blind folded experiment, it was shown that the boys that were exposed, they did less well on this learning task than the unexposed ones. And if you just come back to Sweden, there is a notion that the students that mature the best and learn the best are from schools that traditionally doesn't use very much of this kind of wireless systems. And I'm talking about schools such as Reggio Emilia, Montessori, and Steiner Waldorf schools. And they seem to come out somewhat better. And when I myself have asked municipality civil servants on the western coast of Sweden, because there they had both wireless and wired school, if there were any difference between the learning there, they said no, they couldn't see that at all. Their pupils did just as good. And then I said, well, hey, then you can just as well use wired. And they went very blank in their faces, you know, because they realized that, yeah, they could, of course. Because the things you would get in a wired computer is the same as in a wireless computer. Electricity in our society, many people feel, has been around every time, you know. It has always been here. But that is, of course, not true. One of the oldest electricity plants in the world is in Norway, and it's in the order of 130 years old. And so it's a very short time from an evolutionary point of view. And in the beginning, of course, electricity were only for the very rich people. They could only afford light bulbs and stuff like that. But soon it grew and things became cheaper and cheaper. And for instance, Sweden was said to be completely, with a few exceptions, electrified 1954. But thereafter, we went into the new era of having more and more computerized, digitalized, and so on systems, more electronics. And of course, nowadays, even the simplest home is like a Boeing 747 cockpit, you know. I mean, you can do anything just wirelessly. And still, you know, with all these fashion things and all these technical gadgets, people are not top chefs, for instance. Most people produce pretty bad food, and they're not very intelligent from that point of view. And in Sweden, which is in the schooling system, one of the most computerized schools in the world, as you know, in the PISA investigation recently been produced, we have dropped dramatically. So even with all these mobile phones, readers, tablets, computers, the pupils are not becoming more and more intelligent. On the contrary, they are doing less and less well, which is quite contrary, but it fits very well with what Henry Lai showed in rats and what these other scientists had shown in young boys. So maybe at this very moment, at least the Western world, we are producing kids and students in our schooling system that come out less good than they used to. And I find it very, very hard to believe that any country or any educational minister or any parent would like that. And therefore, I would welcome an open discussion. It's impossible as a scientist, of course, to foresee the future. I don't even know what will happen in the next minute. Something good or bad could suddenly strike us. And if we talk ahead when it comes to costs in our medical and healthcare system, we can only speculate. But if these scientific publications are correct, we may be facing a very big bill down the road. And one thing that is very telling is that the manufacturers, the operators, and the world's insurance companies, they have openly said already for more than 10 years ago, they will not be part of paying that bill. They leave the cost to the society. They want the profit, but the cost, they say, that will have to go to the society. And I was at a meeting 2004 in London, and there were representatives for the manufacturers, the operators, and also lawyers from the insurance industry. And they were all saying that, no way, we will not touch this. We learned the lesson from the tobacco scandal, and we will not repeat it. So they have guarded their own interest. They have their own precautionary principle. And for me, being just a scientist, it's very telling that this is a red alarm clock, you know. And if I were the prime minister or something similar, I would take notice to this. What do they know that we don't? Or do they just know the same as we do and they react because they want to protect their shareholders? The World Health Organization has through their International Agency on Research on Cancer, cancer classified both magnetic fields from power line installations and similar regarding childhood leukemia. That was done 2001. And also 10 years after 2011, radio frequency fields were also cancer classified when it comes down to effects on brain tumors. So they have taken precautionary measures, although from a society point of view, no one seems to listen to them. It is used in discussions and so on, but I don't hear any minister for health or any prime minister saying, hey, we must stop this, you know, we cannot take this risk. Often, however, people that are inside of the wireless industry, I very often see and hear and witness that they take their own measures. They don't allow their own children, for instance, to use these things as their father is selling to all other children in the world, which I find unethical, to say the least, you know. When you look on cells and molecules in various experiments, of course, what comes out as evident is the effect on your genomic material, the genes, the DNA molecule. And when, for instance, Lion Singh and others, many of them after them, exposed DNA molecules to the kind of frequencies and levels that we use in our everyday life, they saw a dramatic increase in damages to this molecule. And such damages could lead to impairments of the immune system, alterations of the future babies to be born and their capacities, and also initiate cancer development. And in the pharmaceutical industry, if you find such genotoxic effects of presumptive medicines, there is new laws and regulations worldwide saying that no, then you cannot develop them further. You cannot use them as a medicine. You cannot sell them to the general population. But that's the pharmaceutical industry. The same goes for the food industry, for instance. But here we have gadgets that everyone carries around that has been shown over and over and over again to be genotoxic, and they are still not withdrawn from the market. Odd.